You're listening to episode 129, Choosing the Direction of Your Life After Bullying with Michael Mapes. Welcome to the Grass Gets Greener podcast, the show for survivors by survivors. I'm your host, Melissa Wilson, a bullying survivor and anti-bullying advocate. And each week you'll hear from a survivor who has overcome a traumatic experience to go on to not only survive, but thrive so that you can too, starting now. Hey there, welcome, and thanks for tuning into this latest episode of the podcast. So grateful to have you here. And I have a great show for you today with Michael Mapes of Graveyard Innovation. And before we get into it, I just want to mention that this episode is sponsored by Navni. Navni is the top-ranked anonymous writing website in the world. Navni provides free wellness resources and low-cost online therapy services to help people cope with various levels of emotional distress. Write anonymously, feel better at novni.com. So what's really cool is that Michael came across this show while just searching for some other stuff. And when he found out I was doing this show, he felt compelled to reach out to me to share his story and his experience with you in the hopes that it can help you in some way. And we get into a lot of great stuff today that I know will support anyone who has been bullied. And if you weren't bullied and instead experienced some other type of trauma or abuse growing up, I believe Michael's message can support you as well. And so Michael is going to share his experience with us today about having been bullied growing up. And through that, we're also going to talk about the messages that bullying sends us as a child and how that impacts us later in life, how Michael deals with any negative comments or bullying he faces now, the different forms that bullying can take, how the bullying really affected Michael's sense of self, the importance of having a tool set that you can turn to during your healing work, how bullying indoctrinates us into a dysfunctional way of thinking and being, and what we can do to shift out of that, and how we get to give ourselves permission to move in the direction of our dreams. So, like I said, lots of good stuff, and I'm excited to bring you this episode. So without further ado, we'll go ahead and get into it, and I'll go bring Michael on. Michael, welcome to the podcast, and thank you for joining me here today to share your story with us.
Thank you for having me on, and thank you for doing the podcast. I was so happy to see that it existed and is hopefully making people's lives a little better.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, and you know, I'm glad to have you here to be a part of it, and I'm glad that you reached out to me about being on the show. And you know, from hearing about what you went through growing up and knowing about the success that you've had in your life since then, I know this will be a really inspiring episode for the listeners, particularly those who have been bullied, and for anyone really who struggled while growing up. And I really look forward to hearing about the journey that has led you to where you are now. So, Michael, what I'd like to do is have you share with us what you'd like us to know about what you experienced growing up, and then we'll go from there. How does that sound to you?
You know, I'm a little nervous, but it sounds good.
Okay. Well, I don't want you to be nervous, and, you know, just share with us, you know, from your heart and what you want us to know and what you think the listeners would like to hear about your story, and we'll go from there. So yeah, just let us know what happened and how old you were when it all began.
So when I was switching from fifth grade to sixth grade, we actually moved from South Dakota to a small town in Northwest Iowa. So it was really started kind of with a lot of just change and transition. I mean, I had gone to school at one place, you know, from kindergarten to preschool up till fifth grade. And then we moved to a different city. And so I was like starting middle school in, you know, a different city. So it's a little bit hard to know if things started because I moved and I was like the new kid, or if it was just that going from fifth to sixth grade. I know for a lot of people, 12, 13, 14 are really difficult years. And when we moved to a new town. We moved in the summer, and then school started in the fall. And I don't remember the exact time frame, but pretty much immediately, like moving to that school, I started facing it was just a lot of bullying. I don't really have another word for it, and it was a lot of things. So like I am gay. I didn't know I was gay then. Although I think that was just more like I wasn't really thinking about sex at that point in my life. But I was more mild mannered. I was shy and pretty soft spoken. I wasn't really into like a lot of things that were other boys were into. So I wasn't into sports. I wasn't into like action movies and things like that. And then most of my friends were girls, which kind of compounded the problem. And so it was really bad, really, really quickly. And I think, but even at that, it took some time, I think, to really wear me down. So I was looking at my old report cards the other day. I had been a straight A student leading up until then. And in sixth grade, I had, barely any absences. In seventh grade, I had dozens of absences. And so it would be just a lot of name calling. It would be a lot of like physical bullying and pushing. And one of the things I think, that you become aware of when you're bullied, and especially when you feel emotionally and physically threatened, is you become very like hyper aware of your space, right? And you become very hyper aware of like almost this preternatural kind of intuitive sense of what environments are safe, what environments aren't safe. And, I was really lucky. I mean, even though my parents were divorced, I did have parents who supported me, especially my mom, who I was closer with and whom I lived with. And, she would go into the school, she would try to get something done. And, there's an experience, really stands out in my mind, because one of the things I think that surprises me, there's kind of two things that stand out, I think, as being the most horrible about it. And often I think people think the name calling, being called the queer, faggot, all of these kind of things, or even the physical pushing from the bullies, I think they think that's the worst. But in my experience, there were kind of two things that were the most haunting. The first is that, there's probably relatively few people that are actually the bullies, but there's a relative lot of people who stand around, see it, hear it, and do nothing. That kind of haunts me to this day. The other thing is, a lot of what was happening is, like, I can remember times when it would be like literally an entire class of people kind of ganging up on me or participating in it, and there would be teachers just sitting there. And I went into the principal's office sometimes. My mom would go into the principal's office, and really wasn't believed. It was, at that time, I'm 33, so this would have been in like 94, 95, 96, 97, that time. There is a lot of boys will be boys. And then, if you don't want to really give people's names because of you're afraid of retaliation. And so then people don't really believe you, or I don't know. I remember the principal saying to me, it's like, you're just doing this for attention, which was just like an odd thing, because like I was clever and I could get attention for positive things, and like achieving things. And so it was a really haunting experience. At one point I was kind of pushed, held against a wall, and had makeup put on me. So it was really harrowing, and it really like wears down your sense of self, your sense of like self-esteem. And so I would, not want to go to school. I would fake being sick or come up with excuses to leave all of the time. My grades really suffered, really went to being more of a B and C student, and just really disengaged and emotionally shut down. And it wasn't really until, and that really continued sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, pretty horribly. Moving into high school, I mean, things improved a little bit as it went on. It was still bad in the beginning, and I'll never forget, I was sitting in my freshman English or language arts class, whatever it was. And, someone called me, I think, a faggot or something. I can't remember. And I just sat there like I didn't react to it at all. And I remember the teacher like stopping and sending that person to the principal's office. And she held me after class. And I just honestly, I just assumed like, oh, I was getting in trouble as well, because that was kind of like the normal pattern of things. And she stopped and she said, like, how often does that happen? I was like, oh, it happens all the time. And she just said, she was like, I'm just shocked because you didn't react to it. You didn't respond to it at all. Because it was really so normalized. And she said to me, she goes, you know, that's not like okay. That like shouldn't happen. And that was just such a game changer for me. Like, it didn't make all of the bullying stop. It didn't make everything go away. But like that one person saying like, this is not okay. This is not going to happen here. It gave me like so much confidence. And I was lucky because I got involved in like debate in high school. And so I had a debate coach who really believed in me, and she believed in me and like made me the editor of the paper when I was a junior. And it's just really powerful. And I think for me, it's like really, someone doesn't have to fix the entire situation or make everything stop to let you know that that's not the way that things should be. So that was kind of my experience. It's pretty shocking, yeah, actually, to even think back on it, really.
Mm. Well, thank you for sharing all of that with us. And as I was listening to it, I can relate to so much of it in what I experienced. You know, for me, it was seventh and eighth grades. And I had gone into a new school where I knew a couple people, but didn't really know anybody. And I was the outsider. And, you know, I don't know if that's why I was bullied or, you know, if it was some other reason, but that was my situation. And yeah, you know, and hearing you talk about like the two things that were like most impactful for you in that situation with there, you know, people standing by and seeing it happen and not doing anything. I mean, that happened in my case as well. And then also, you know, talking about how you had like, you know, a whole group of people kind of participating in it and teachers seeing it and not doing anything. And that happened with me too. And it's just so, it's just sad, you know, when that sort of thing happens.
It's like an emperor's, like the emperor has no clothes, like story, right? Because if you say to someone, this entire class of people is picking on me, bullying me, harassing me, whatever the case may be, that doesn't seem believable on the mm-hmm. face of it. It seems like, well, that can't happen, right? Yeah. Like somebody would say something, somebody would do something. And so that's super invalidating of like your own experience. And I think one thing that like I've heard Catherine McKinnon say is we don't trust our own experience. We trust what power tells us about our experience. And that's a huge problem because you start to sort of think like, did this really happen? Am I crazy? And I think it's not about if you could take it into a court of law or something and prove it happened. But it is so important for people, I think, to hold on to your own experience, hold on to your own narrative, and hold on to your own story, because there was something inside of me that, like, against all the odds, like, there was some part of myself that I never lost. And I think it's so, you know, like, it doesn't matter if a lot of other people believe it. It matters that you know what occurred. Mm-hmm. And at some point, you know, if you're a child, like, at some point, you're going to become an adult and you're going to gain relatively more power, relatively more influence. And at that point, you can share your story, share your narrative, share your experience. And I think, you know, I think that really for adults, it's so important to listen to children. There's so much condescension of young people. And I find that so unhelpful and so diminishing and demeaning, because I think really it's like listening and valuing the experience of people who have been through something different than ourselves. Is it's one of the ways that we learn about the world. It's one of the ways that we learn about ourselves. It's one of the ways that we develop empathy so that we can do something about these things if we ever get into such a position to be able to affect change in that way. So I think I was lucky that when I was going to school, you know, there really wasn't social media. I didn't have a cell phone. So at least like when I went home and my family, you know, my grandmother and my mother and my grandfather, you know, they did believe me and they did tell me I was loved. So I had this little enclave of safety. Mm. And I think that really kind of got me through.
That's good. Yeah. And I think when you're going through that, you're just looking for someone who's going to be there in your corner, you know, there to support you and let you know that like they see you and they see what's going on and, you know, that you're not alone and you don't have to deal with it on your own. Because, I mean, I felt like I had to just handle it all by myself. And I was afraid to tell anyone because I didn't want, like, my mother to go in there and kind of make a big deal out of it. And then, you know, I was afraid that that would make the situation worse for me. But that really just sent me a message at that age that, you know, I had to take care of things myself, that I couldn't rely on other people. And that's really not, that's not a helpful thing for someone at that age to learn, you know.
And it kicks up in all these other situations in your life. And, you know, I remember for years and years after going through this well into college, I think it really, it's such an isolating experience, even though a lot of people have experienced it, you know, and it's such a, it feels like something is wrong with you. And you can know at some level that it's not. But it just feels, I think, like there's something broken, wrong, dirty, unacceptable, or that you did to deserve it, right? Because we have this idea, like, okay, what? Well, if someone's being angry toward you, you must have done something, right? Mm-hmm. And that's not, first off, we have in a culture, I mean, then as now, that values mediocrity, that values conformity. And so anyone who is creative or different or, you know, they're often punished for that, unfortunately. And that's a cultural issue that gets played out on an individual level. And I think you're exactly right that this is really the thing. It's not that you can get out of a bullying situation, but if those bonds of trust in your community, trust in other people, it can give you an incredible self-reliance and resilience. And you can also take that way too far, where you're avoiding things or you're anxious or, like you said, you're not asking for help, which I think
you're not asking for help when you need it.
Exactly. And you just feel like people don't understand you, people, you know, and that's not a way to live a life, right? Mm-hmm. And it comes with a lot of other problems in your interpersonal relationships if you don't resolve that in some way, you know, be it through psychotherapy or personal growth and development or exercise and nutrition or all of the above.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So when did the bullying, like, finally end for you?
You know, there was a way in which, like, I don't know that it, just because of who I am and how I live my life, that it ever has or exactly will, you know, in a sense of, like, you know, do I really fear for my safety? No. And I have a pretty thick skin at this point. There's not really anything that I think someone could say at this point that would be all that shocking to me. But, you know, I do live a semi-public life. I, you know, I'm an author. I've published books and I have, you know, videos and radio appearances and articles that I've written. And, you know, I'm a pretty strong, I have a strong voice and I have a strong will and I'm an extremely stubborn person. And so, yeah, I mean, there are still a lot of, like, comments and hate and, frankly, just bigotry and diminishment that comes to me to this day, you know. And that's the thing. At some point, it's like, I think it ceases to matter. It ceases to be so, it just ceases to have a resonance with you because you sort of know who you are and you know what you're about and you know your values. I can't say it never sings. I mean, it still does. But I think, you know, as far as really the intensity, it basically stopped when I moved and went to college. But ask any, you know, gay person or lesbian person or trans person, you know, and there's still in every single part of this country, liberal or conservative, you know, walking down the street as a gay person is still likely to elicit hateful comments from time to time, as is being a woman walking down many streets in this country, right? And that's just existing, let alone if you actually run for office or put yourself out there publicly or, you know, deign to get any amount of influence or power, then I think, you know, the forces of conformity and status quo, I think they'll be there to confront you, but hopefully they'll be less, hopefully you'll get on with the business of just doing your work anyways, I think.
Yeah, and, you know, I mean, we can't control what other people are going to do or say to us, but, you know, we can certainly control our reaction to it. And I guess, you know, as we get older, we can, as we become more comfortable with who we are, it makes us more resilient to those things. And so when that stuff happens, you know, yes, like you said, sometimes it's still going to sting, but we don't have that same reaction to it that we might have had, you know, back then when we were a child.
And I hope that we can, like, I think that's really wise. And I would say too, you know, harassment and bullying, it comes in all kinds of forms. And I think it has to do with shrinking somebody's sense of self, shrinking how much space someone is like allowed to take up in the world. And whether or not you allow people to do that to you as an adult, I mean, you have a say in that. And you don't have to like let people shrink who you are, silence your voice, or stand down. And I think you develop a discernment about when and how to speak out. And, you know, sometimes it's better to take somebody aside and just make them aware of perhaps their actions. And sometimes it's better to speak out more publicly. And sometimes it really is better to turn the other cheek and ignore it. And I think hopefully the older that I've gotten, I think I have a discernment with that. And I also think that you know, bullying comes in all shapes and sizes. My mom is actually one of the foremost experts in the country on workplace bullying and workplace aggression. And, you know, a lot of other countries have laws against that. We don't in America yet. And there's, you know, there's a lot of consciousness raising that needs to happen. And I think a lot of people who weren't bullied as children, but then find themselves in this situation as adults, it's really shocking to them. They really don't know how to deal with it. And, you know, and that comes in all forms, whether it's racism, sexism, homophobia, whether it's, you know, classism, whether it's ageism. I think, you know, hurtful, hateful viciousness comes in all forms. And, you know, one of the things that I think about being bullied is I want to be more aware of the different forms that it takes. And I was with my friend who happens to be Black a few weeks ago, and we were in a restaurant, and this woman just came through and just really kind of pushed him out of the way, and just through, and I could tell it humiliated him, it irritated him, and I was uncomfortable by it and didn't really know what to do in that situation. And just through like listening to him and hearing from him and having my own consciousness raised, it's like now I'm able to kind of think, okay, what would I do next time if that situation happens, and how would I handle it? And I would encourage people to do that. Like, we're not always going to get it right in every situation. We're not always going to know how to handle it. We're not always going to be perfect, but we can have empathy. We can listen. And that's where I think, you know, sharing and hearing someone else's story, how something else, you know, made them feel, I think there's a deep power in that. And we know that there is so much evidence about the power of storytelling and the power of both inviting someone else to hear our story, listening to someone else's story, not having to judge that, again, when we're telling someone our story, it's not about if we could litigate it in a court of law, you know, by the rules of like evidence or something. But there's a power and a shared humanity and really a companionship and a community that can be built out of listening to those stories. And I would hope that my own experience with bullying would just make me more open to hearing, you know, the experiences of other people and how they might, you know, feel in the world. And certainly, if I was, you know, doing anything that made someone feel uncomfortable, I would want to know and be able to think that through and maybe make a different decision.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Michael, I know we've talked a little bit about, you know, the ways that you were impacted by having been bullied, but, you know, share with us a little bit more about that and how it really just affected your life as you were, you know, becoming an adult.
I mean, it affected me negatively in almost every way that I can think about. It made me extremely mistrustful of friendships and self-sabotaging. It made me, you know, really prone to drinking a lot, to messing around with drugs at certain points in my life, just trying to find something to, I really numb the pain. It made me, you know, it impacted my romantic relationships, and, you know, negatively. It impacted my grades negatively, and really my ability and willingness to follow through and to see something through. It made me depressed and it made me anxious. And, you know, when I was 19, I went into my closet and put a rope around my neck and tried to hang myself. And I woke up the next morning, the closet all broken to pieces. And I actually took a semester off college and sought psychotherapy. And really, that's when I launched my first business 6 months after that occurred. And, you know, that's really the point that I got to, because there was so much inner pain that I just did not see a way out of.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know that I could ask for help. I didn't know how or what help to ask for. I really felt like it was just something that was broken and wrong in me. It really robbed me, I think, of my sense of any independent self. And I think that's hard for people who have a healthy sense of self. I think that's really hard to understand. Those are kind of the consequences for me. And luckily, you know, I didn't succeed in taking my own life. Many, many people who've experienced bullying have, you know. And so
yeah.
I just happened to be lucky enough that, you know, I didn't succeed and that I do have another chance. But, you know, those were really the consequences for me. And that all kind of compounds because it's this sense of then failure. It's this sense of I'm letting these people win. It's this sense of, I think, just complete overwhelm. And people respond to that in different ways. You know, I really responded to numbing and by finding myself very just depressed.
And you said you went into therapy?
Yeah,
what was that like for you?
You know, I really think it's important for people to look into, you know, there's many different kinds of therapy. You know, I'm really a fan of psychotherapy and psychoanalytic therapy. I'm a fan of narrative therapy. A lot of people see cognitive behavioral therapy, which I think can be great, especially for giving you some of those coping skills to get out of it. I had a good experience mm-hmm. in therapy. I wasn't in it for long. I actually, for me, it kind of really coincided with a lot of personal growth and development. So while I was only in therapy for probably 6 months. I mean, I had a little bit of therapy like in middle school and high school, but I just really wasn't, it didn't do much for me then. But as an adult, I did about 6 months, and then I really was more drawn to actually, like, I got deeply into meditation, which I really do think saved my life. And I've been, meditating seriously for, I don't know, 15, 16 years at this point. I sought life coaching. You know, I've worked with many, many different life coaches, and that was really a fantastic experience. For me personally, did a lot of self-help kind of stuff, and, you know, that was good. I mean, that was all just like a part of where I was at that time, you know? And it helped. I mean, I think all of these things are tools, right? They're tools to help you find the, what was lost, the essence of who you are, the core of who you are. And I think, I think people really need to, you know, search for the combination of things
that find what works for them. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I love to have my guests, you know, share about what's helped them so that the listeners can explore those things for themselves and figure out what is going to be something that's going to help them, you know.
And life is so not linear, you know. And I think sometimes because we think, oh, I was struggling and then I overcame something. That's not really, we do things in waves. We do things in levels. And, you know, when you're working on something, whether that's, you know, losing weight and getting healthy, whether that is making money and becoming successful, whether that is finding a romantic partner or making a relationship work, there's good days and bad days. There's days that we take two steps forward. There's days we take a couple steps back. And I think it's really just about having a tool set that you can go to, whether that's affirmations, meditation, seeking psychotherapy, a friend that you can call, you know, different things for different. Like for me, I actually find music and poetry to be deeply, deeply healing. And so weirdly, you know, the poems of Emily Dickinson were deeply healing to me and continue to be deeply healing. So I think it comes in many forms, and it's really about it's not so much about did I transcend this thing once and for all, but I think it's more about allowing yourself to continually be in process and mm-hmm. to get back to the way that you want to live when you feel that you've fallen short of that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's
something
so
like trauma mm-hmm. didn't occur in a day, you know, it didn't occur in 5 minutes. So the mm-hmm. healing is kind of I just look at it as really a lifelong journey. And often we think we're like falling backward when we're not. We're just spiraling up, you know, and we just are kind of experiencing something we've been through before in another level. It's like, as you can handle more, then more of the pain will like be processed within you, right? And that's okay. That doesn't, that's actually like a normal thing. And I guess for me, I think, you know, mindfulness and just knowing that emotion is not the enemy. Feeling pain is not going to kill you. And you may need to do that with like the support of a therapist or the support of a coach or the support of family or friends, or for some people, probably their faith or, you know, whatever. Because you certainly don't have to do that alone. But we need to let those emotions run through us. We need to give ourselves permission to feel whatever that is, whether that's anger and rage, bitterness, whether that is just helplessness, all of that is okay. And so often it's the suppression of those emotions, as I see it, or the denial of those emotions, or the justifications that we paper over those emotions that just stops. Like, your body, your mind, your emotional system, it knows how to process those emotions. And we often didn't feel safe enough when we were 12, 13, 14, 15, because we quite literally weren't safe enough, right, to be able to process those emotions. But as a grown-up, it's remembering that you really are and then finding the support that you need, because all of that stuff is still in you, right? That hurt child, that hurt teenager, that person who never got what they needed. And yeah, I think that's been really just knowing that I can be mindful and let those emotions run through me. They're not going to break me, however much I might feel like they are. You know, that's been, you know, really, really, really powerful.
Yeah. And I think it's so important to just allow ourselves to go easy on ourselves when we're having a bad day or we feel like we're having a setback, you know, and it's about collecting these tools so that when we are having that bad day, we can turn to something and we can get out of it quicker. You know,
there's so much toxic shame and guilt and, you know, secret shadows that people are holding around. And I think, you know, most people are walking around in so much of their own pain that they're missing that's the one thing as humans that unites us. It's the one thing that we are all going to experience is pain and suffering. And we don't need to equivocate and we don't need to compare. It's just that there is a common humanity in hurt, pain, heartache, struggle. And if we're not being gentle with ourselves and we're not exercising a level of being okay with ourselves and of giving really the gentleness that many of us didn't get in our childhoods or that many of us didn't get at critical moments of our life, then we're not going to be able to exercise that gentleness with others. Mm-hmm. And we're not going to be able to, recognize we're not going to have compassion and sympathy and empathy for others. It's like, I think most of us become so good at judging others because we use ourselves as test subjects. And I really think that is such wasted emotion, you know, shame and guilt, and I just find it toxic. And so if you little by little can just start to be okay and give yourself permission to be wherever you are without judgment, there's a real power in that over time. And it's a muscle and it's a new way of thinking, right? Like, what bullying does is it indoctrinates you into a dysfunctional way of thinking and a dysfunctional way of being, and it indoctrinates you into a wrong and unreal set of beliefs about yourself. And so what you have to do is slowly, you know, inject love, slowly inject a more compassionate, caring, loving, and forgiving belief system into your consciousness.
Yeah, you're just retraining your mind.
Absolutely.
So, Michael, how are you doing today? Are there things that you still struggle with?
I mean, no, I'm perfect. I would say there are. I think one of the things that I believe is that words are extremely powerful, and every single person on this planet has a voice, and how we use that voice is our choice. And you know, I think the greatest aspiration, the greatest thing I aspire to, my greatest value is human kindness. To be kinder to myself and to be kinder to others. And I fail at that a lot. But I do aspire. I do work toward it. And I do think I'm getting better. And so, you know, really where I've come is I'm an introverted person. I've always been an introverted person. I'm a person who does things my own way. And I'm also a deeply sensitive person. And where I've come is, you know, I can't necessarily stop the fact that certain things people say might hurt my feelings, but I can certainly stop whether or not I let that stop me, whether or not I let that paralyze me. And so, you know, really one of the things for me that has been fantastic is when I took a semester out of college, I started my first business at the age of 19. I'm 33 right now, and I run a company called Graveyard Innovation, which is a results-driven innovation firm. So we design and execute winning strategies for people with original ideas. So all of the different thinkers and creative imaginators and, you know, all these people with these unique ideas that people think are impossible, that's really who we support. And then I also run a speaking agency where we book gigs for, you know, people that have these kind of original messages that are looking to get it out into the world. So part of how I deal with, you know, my pain and part of how I deal with the remnants of the struggle of bullying is by helping empower other people to speak their truth, use their voice, and find agency in the face of some pretty overwhelming odds, you know? And whether or not you move in the direction of your dream, you are the one who has permission to do that. You are the one who gives yourself permission to do that. So for me, it's a lot about helping others in that way. If something seems too crazy, too hard, too impossible, but I think it needs to be in the world, then that's really what I want to be, you know, a part of. Because there, I didn't know anybody who was an entrepreneur growing up, and I didn't know that all the ways that I thought differently and all the ways that I thought creatively, like, I just thought those were bad things about myself. I didn't know that there was a power in those things. And so I would hope that the work that we do in Graveyard Innovation and the Be Song Mate Speaking Agency is showing people that if you don't like the world that you live in because there's a lot wrong with it, and I don't like the world that we live in right now, then contribute to making that world differently, beginning with how can I make my own world, my own life differently. And that might be through entrepreneurship or a business or doing a podcast or having a blog. It might just be by being a great mother or father or community member or volunteering. Or, you know, I think sometimes we neglect the small things and then it really makes the big things seem impossible. So it's like, look around and start with where you are. Sometimes on our own behalf, we don't really know what direction to go in. But I think sometimes if we're willing to do things for others, if we think about what might I give to others, whether or not that's a smile to someone on the street, whether or not that's a gentle word, whether or not that's writing an email to someone to tell them that they impacted you. I mean, there's a lot that we can do on an individual level. And if you don't practice your power in small ways, you won't be prepared when the world or your calling or the circumstances are such that you need to use your power in big ways.
Wow, that's really great. I mean, it sounds like, you know, you're doing some amazing work and just you have such a great message that you're sharing with people. So tell me, like, did you ever think back then that you would be, you know, living the life that you do now?
No.
Yeah. Yeah, we can't see that. We don't see that for ourselves. It's
no.
Back then we have no hope. And
I think part of being bullied is that often so much of your energy gets shifted into survival mode.
Mm-hmm.
Because what bullying does is it disrupts the narrative that we have. You know, I had a narrative up until fifth grade that going to school was safe, that my the speaking out and answering in class would be appreciated, right? That people wanted me to be myself, right? We get these mixed messages of like, be yourself. Well, being myself became the most dangerous thing that I could do. So all of my energy went to hiding, camouflaging, fitting in, trying to shrink into the wall, not be noticed, and hide everything actually good and interesting about myself. So I didn't think that having all these interesting and original ideas, I just thought, again, I thought those were negative things about myself. So the idea that I could have used those things to build a business or to contribute, it just wouldn't have occurred to me in any way.
It's so amazing that you've been able to go from that place to where you are now, you know, and I'm sure it's just all the work that you've done on yourself to get you here.
I think I benefited in a way from, I never really thought I could do anything, and that was a huge benefit in the beginning, because, in a way, I thought, okay, I'll just try, you know, I'll just, I just, the expectations were so low, And that's one of the benefits of being like a black sheep or not fitting in. It's like, on the one hand, it's very discouraging because people don't believe in you. But on the other hand, there are no rules and no expectations, so you can make your own. And I think that's the power of it, right? Like, I wasn't so afraid to move in the direction of building a business because I just never really thought I could do it. So I thought, well, why not try and just fail, and then I'll know and I can do something else. But actually what happened is, and I have failed a lot, like a lot. But I also succeeded at a few key things and a few key moments. And eventually I developed this kind of attitude of, well, I just want to see if I can do this, right? That's served me well.
Mm. Nice. So, Michael, I want to ask you the final question that I have for you today. And that is, given what you know now, if you could go back to when you were going through your tough times and give yourself one piece of advice, what would it be?
Wow. I think what I would say to myself is, no one can make you quit. No one can make you give up but you. No one else gets to say when, who you are or what your life is going to be about. And, you know, I think I would just want to go back and say to myself, everything that you are, everything that you think you need to change, right, is someday going to be the thing that lets you build really successful businesses, that lets you travel all over the world, that lets you become a best-selling author, and, you know, that lets you, even though I'm divorced, right, that lets you find someone who loves you and have a life that is so much more than anything that you can imagine. You know, that's really what I would want to tell myself. When Hillary Clinton ran for president in 2008, she said, keep faith and never let anyone tell you that you can't or shouldn't go on. And I think that is the most powerful thing that I would say to anybody, wherever you are, right? And whatever you're going through, keep faith and really, truly never let anyone tell you that you can't or shouldn't go on.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. We are in control of more than we realize. And I think, you know, when we're going through that as a child, you know, we think that we have no control over what happens to us or what we get to do. But it's not true, you know, and it's, we get to grow up and embrace who we are and choose, you know, what direction our life is going to go in.
Yes, I think that that's exactly right. You know, and I would say to anyone who is listening to this who maybe hasn't been bullied, there is such a power in one voice saying, this is not okay, or I don't want to be a part of this, or everyone else might think this about you and I don't. And sometimes that doesn't stop the taunting, and sometimes you might think it doesn't matter at all, and I am telling you, it matters.
Absolutely. So, Michael, before I let you go, what is the best way for people to connect with you or find out more about what you have going on?
Yes. So you can email me if you would like. So my email is m@graveyardinnovation.com. Or you can call our business line or send a text to our business line, which is 309-430-9836. Or you can go to graveyardinnovation.com and get in touch with us that way. And I would love if you would reach out. I mean, please don't. You won't bother me. I wanna hear from you. So anytime, text or call, day or night. And I'd love to hear from anyone.
That's great. Thank you for that. And I'll have that stuff linked up on your show notes page as well. So other than that, Michael, I just want to thank you for coming on here today. You know, for sharing your story with us. And I know you had mentioned to me when you reached out that you had wished there, you know, had been something like this podcast 20 years ago when you first began struggling with bullying. So thank you for being a part of it today and for helping others who are struggling right now.
The idea that someone could go online and type in bullying and come across your show is so, like, it just, I'm in awe of that. So, yeah, so thank you. Because that was unimaginable to me, you know, when I was growing up. So I think sometimes we think about the negatives of the internet, but there are also some incredibly powerful and hopeful and transformational things that it offers. And your show is just evidence of that. So thank you.
Oh, thank you. All right. And I hope that you have a great rest of your day.
You too.
Thanks for listening to the show today. This has been the Grass Gets Greener podcast, episode 129. Go to thegrassgetsgreener.com/Michael Mapes, that's M-A-P-E-S, to find the links mentioned during this episode or to leave a comment. So I hope you found Michael's story inspiring, and I just want to reiterate his answer to the final question, that no one can make you quit or give up but you. So you get to choose what your life is going to look like now. You can take your power back, and you deserve to take your power back. And make use of the tools that are out there that can help you with that. And feel free to reach out to Michael if his story resonated with you today. I know he'd be happy to hear from you. And I'm always happy to hear from you too, of course. And come back in 2 weeks for the next episode. And speaking of tools, don't forget to head over to the website to grab your free copy of the Top 10 Strategies Guide for Survivors. In it, you'll find the top 10 most common strategies my podcast guests have used for overcoming the effects of past trauma. It's a great place to get started if you're looking for some strategies that can help you in your healing, as they have helped my guests. And you can find that at thegrassgetsgreener.com/guide, or also on the show notes page. So be sure to grab that if you haven't yet. And lastly, don't forget to head over to iTunes or Stitcher to leave the show a rating and review so that we can reach as many survivors as possible. And as always, have hope.